On any network, security controls are needed on multiple levels, as without a layered approach, you could be victim of an attack. Passive attacks are things such as traffic sniffing or scanning, and these are done during reconnaissance to discover information about a network. Active attacks are designed to interrupt service, destroy data, or steal information. Here we see a depiction of the 7-layer OSI model. There is a potential for attacks in every layer of the OSI model. We'll take one more step and separate this, and I'll show you that the first two layers, layer 1 and layer 2, are essentially hardware attacks. Layers 3 through 7 are more directed at software attacks. So now let's go through each layer, starting at layer 7, the application layer. The application layer is where we initiate contact with the network. Attacks can include software attacks, and these are designed to exploit some weakness in the code. There could be phishing via email or pop-ups, and malware such as viruses, ransomware, trojans, and worms. The presentation layer is where the data is presented to the application so we can view it. Attacks include forced browsing, and this is also called a failure to restrict URL access. Now, this will allow access to authenticated areas without proper credentials. And then there's an SSL TLS strip. Now, this is a man-in-the-middle attack, where a malicious actor is between a client and a server. Here we see the attacker in the middle, and the malicious actor will monitor, capture, and control the communication with the goal of obtaining sensitive information, such as usernames and passwords. The session layer is responsible for initiating, maintaining, and tearing down a session. A couple of attacks can take place at this layer. Session hijacking is also known as cookie hijacking. It grabs the session key to gain access to the services. A session initiation protocol, or SIP flood, is where clients are flooded with multiple invite messages in order to take down the phone. And a DNS poison attack. And now this is where fake address records are inserted into the DNS cache so that any requests for the address are answered with a fake IP address. The transport layer is responsible for transportation of the data. At the transport layer, there are a few attacks that include port scanning. This is simply a reconnaissance attack to see what ports are open and listening. And a SYN flood. Now, this floods the server with multiple SYN packets with no final acknowledgement. The result is that it overwhelms the server so that legitimate users are locked out. The network layer is responsible for addressing and routing. In this layer, we can see the following. We can see operating system fingerprinting using ICMP. Now, this again is a passive attack to determine the operating system of the host. There could be routing attacks, which are done to misdirect traffic. An IP spoofing attack is where data appears to be coming from another source. A replay attack is where a malicious actor intercepts credentials and then uses the credentials to gain access to a protected resource. And there are numerous ICMP attacks, such as a SMURF attack, which is a distributed denial of service attack. At the data link layer, this is where the data is ready to be transmitted onto the network. Here we could see the following. We can see network sniffing, which is simply eavesdropping, and this is common in a local area network. WPA cracking, which is done on a wireless network to decrypt the encrypted packets. And ARP cache poisoning, which is used in a man-in-the-middle attack. Now, the physical layer is really simply a physical attack, and that can include theft of devices, cutting cables, or a skimming attack, where someone attaches a device to an ATM or point of sale system to gather credit card numbers. On a network, security controls are needed on multiple levels, as an attack can happen at every layer of the OSI model.